Alright guys, we recording?
Yep.
Alright. Hi everybody. Welcome to Gary Con.
Your mic's not on.
Dude, it's not close.
Oh, it's on.
Thank you, Peanut Gallery. Hi everybody. Welcome to Gary Con. Welcome to Lake Geneva, Wisconsin. Welcome to the What's New with Goodman Games seminar. I'm Joseph Goodman of Goodman Games, and I'm going to pass this around so these guys can introduce themselves as well.
I am Michael Curtis of Goodman Games, I guess. Okay.
I am Joe Bittman of Earth.
Lies.
Brendan LaSalle, also of Goodman Games.
Doug.
So thanks everybody for coming today. We're gonna talk you through some of the stuff we've done recently, some of the things we're working on, and some things we are excited to announce that'll be coming out later this year. So first of all, I just wanted to say thank you to everybody here who helped support us over the last year. As you guys know, the industry is transitioning from a model of traditional retail and distribution towards the more direct sales model, and Kickstarter is a big part of that. And Kickstarter can be really impressive because you can take what is going to start out as a very short module and end up with a very long box set. So you guys did an amazing job over the last year helping us produce amazing products. We ended up with Peril on the Purple Planet, The Chain Coffin, written by this guy right here. Did a phenomenal job. X-Crawl, written by this guy right here, did a phenomenal job. Featuring Aaron on the cover. If you guys don't know, that guy right there is on the cover, the guy with the beard. The guy with the beard. That doesn't work around here. Anyway, get him to sign it. He's not the one in the bikini, in case you're wondering. Age of Cthulhu, Starfall over the Plateau of Lang. Just a lot of really great products. And of course, Metamorphosis Alpha. And I have here one of the only shipping boxes in existence that was not shipped. So it's the one pristine copy I'll sell on eBay when I want to retire. So this is the Kickstarter edition, which turned out amazing. I'm showing this off for a reason. I'm going to show off, I mean, this is an amazing book, and it's probably one of the biggest game books I've ever seen. But later on, I'm going to show you an even bigger game book, and I want Jim Ward to get game book envy. So that for his next book, he'll make it even bigger. Anyway, all these products were made possible by you guys, so thank you. You did a great job. So now let's talk about bigger books. So you guys will see over there, on the very crooked poster that Doug is trying to fix, the cover art for Teagle Manor. And by the way, nobody really knows how to pronounce it. So as we discussed at Gen Con, Bob Bledsoe of Judges Guild is working with us to bring back a lot of the classic Judges Guild products. This is a really fun project because a lot of these materials were produced in the quote golden age of gaming back in the late 70s and early 80s, and they're really good products. And the process ultimately will be a big oversized hardcover where we scan all this in and produce for posterity every version of these products that were produced. Like Teagle Manor, for example, was done in 4 different printings and they're all slightly different. And part of the goal is to record some of those changes and how things evolved over time. And in the short term, what we're doing is, for example, here at Gary Con, releasing the Gary Con edition of Teagle Manor, which you can buy at our booth. You doing okay over there, Doug?
I'm trying. Trying to do it.
All right, we did it. Good job. And this is the edition that it's the bait and switch. It says $4.50 at the top, then it says $24.99 at the bottom.
That's how we get you.
Yeah, I think it's one of my more embarrassing editorial oversights. But anyway, it's awesome. It's a reprint of the original Teagle Manor. But the goal is to eventually produce a monster volume that has everything in it. So this is the printer mock-up of what the Judges Guild book will be.
Oh my goodness. Yeah.
No offense, Jim, it's bigger than yours.
You just had to do that, didn't you? You just had to be bigger than mine.
Bigger's better.
Yeah, so, and the goal of this is to produce a book that can hold the original oversized maps and the original Judges Guild journals. Let me show you what this looks like.
Wow.
So this is one of the extremely rare copies of the Judges Guild Journal. They're rare not just because there weren't that many, but because they were printed on newsprint and they've pretty much all been destroyed. If you get a hold of one, you'll see it actually fits on these pages perfectly. So that's the goal. You can come check it out when you get up here if you'd like. But also the other interesting part is these pages, if printed as gatefolds, which means if it folds open, are big enough to hold, for example, the original Teagle Manor map, which was printed on 24 by 36 inch paper back in, I forget which one, the second or third printing of Teagle Manor. So this book should be able to, or this format should be able to preserve the original Judges Guild books in their original oversized format in a way that fits on a bookshelf, kind of, if you've got a big bookshelf. But it's a really neat format, and I'm very excited about it. So we just finished all the scans, finally. There's been some folks doing a whole lot of work scanning all these things. Now we're in the process of cleaning them up and laying them out, and it'll still be several months probably before we have the Kickstarter ready to go, but it's progressing pretty well. So we're pretty excited.
Put your money away is what he's saying.
Yeah, start saving now. This book will be more than $4.50, I'm afraid to say.
But if you want to get a jump on the Kickstarter, we have available downstairs. We have... There is the Teagle Manor, the special Gary Con version of it, which reproduces this version of it and has new material that we've added in the back. We've actually expanded a little bit, which was done in the style of 1976. So
who wrote that new material?
The Curtis guy. So yeah, so it's highly suspect. So yeah. So we had a lot of fun. John Hirschberger, talked with John. He went above and beyond the call of duty. I think he got a little manic because he tracked down the perfect fonts to represent the original Teagle Manor when he put it together. He was very proud of that.
I've never had so many font emails in like a 2-week period. Yeah, lots of samples. We got the right one.
So buy it and then find Taco and have him sign the credits page. You know, because he's very happy with it.
Cool.
Would you like to use the microphone?
No. All right. So next up, Vanna, if you don't mind, would you flip the next panel? Yeah, bearded Vanna.
You guys ready?
Yeah. We're warming up, Doug. We're warming up.
Okay. This is just digital art. No, it's like a bank painting. So I use the computer to like skip 10 years of studying.
Luckily, nobody can hear Doug because he doesn't have the microphone.
Whatever.
So I'm going to talk a little bit about 5th edition. And avoiding edition wars entirely, it is the current edition of D&D, whether we all like it or not. But a lot of people, the great news is I've heard that a lot of people do like it. People are generally saying it's a lot better than the last one. And they seem to prefer it in many cases as their number 2 edition of D&D, which is a pretty big compliment because we all have a favorite we grew up with or really love. So we released 2 adventures at Gen Con last year, and they did really well. And there appears to be a strong base of support. Now I've published stuff for 3rd edition, 4th edition, now 5th edition, and learned a couple lessons along the way. So the first lesson was we put out 2 things to see how they're going to do, and they keep on rolling. So based on that, we're going to release a couple more 5th edition products. So the 5th edition, the next 2 coming up are the Pillars of Pelagia and Warlock. They'll be launching in a Kickstarter in a couple weeks. And these are simple, you know, roughly 16-page, $10 adventure modules. The goal is just something you can play in 1, maybe 2 sessions with your 5th edition game. And 5th edition easily ports into a lot of other versions of D&D, so it's pretty easy to adapt. And then we're also going to try to do a free RPG Day module this year featuring a 5th edition product. So that'll be part of the Kickstarter if we do well enough. We'll get that produced. So Mike here wrote one of these. Maybe Mike would like to talk about it.
So I did Glitter Doom, which was the first one, and this is not a sequel to it, but it has a one-word title. Although I did throw in a hyphen, so I'm getting stuck. So this is Warlock. This is a 5th level adventure. It kind of goes back again. One of the things I like about 5th edition is that it does remind me the simplicity of kind of the earlier versions of the rules. So it gives me a little bit more freedom to expand on it. It's a little bit longer contents wise than Glitter Doom. Because we were just kind of testing the waters, trying to figure out what was worked. This is partially a hex crawl and partially a dungeon, so it kind of goes back to the old, you know, the old school design mentality to it. It's very atmospheric. We have a burning forest fire going on in the hills, and strange rumblings, and you know, an ancient evil rising up, and you kind of get sucked into it. And we had a heck of a lot of fun playtesting it, and I'm very happy the way it turned out. So I'm hoping that if you want to give 5th edition a chance, try the 5th edition fantasy line. We have Chris Doyle, he's coming up with his. Chris has a long history of working with her. He's done like something like 14, 15 titles or something with you. Yeah. So Chris knows what he's doing. So I'm just very happy to be part of it, and I hope that you guys all continue to embrace it and we get to do more of them. So.
And if you guys enjoyed our products in the 3rd edition era, Chris Doyle wrote a whole lot of those, starting with DCC number 7, if I remember correctly. He's been around forever. He also wrote Castle White Rock, or co-wrote Castle White Rock, which is a monster of a book. He holds the record for turning in the biggest violation of a writing contract I've ever had. I think Castle White Rock was assigned as a 64-page module, or maybe 96. Mm-hmm. He comes back a couple months later, he's like, I wrote 700 pages. Along with his co-author. But yeah, it was like, really? I'm only paying you what I contracted for. No, but he did an amazing job in Castle White Rock, and that, even though the edition is now 3rd and not, you know, currently played, people still pick that up and love it. So Chris is a great adventure writer, and you'll probably enjoy some of his work.
So what you're saying is that, you know, we've got nothing to worry about now. So when Rob and I go over like by 1,000 words, you know, that's all cool.
Yeah, when she goes, oh, I can go over by 10,000 words now, right?
Okay. Yeah. Always give us a new benchmark to shoot for.
Right.
All right.
So now we're going to talk about Dungeon Crawl Classics. If you don't mind, Joe, could you flip that poster, please? And yeah, do you mind flipping that one too, Doug? Thanks. So there's kind of a lot of ground to cover here, so I'm going to start with a couple updates and then we'll talk through some more details. You like that art, Doug?
Okay.
Is that digital?
It goes into Photoshop at some point, so that's when I fix everything.
I fix everything in Photoshop.
So first, let me give you an update on the dice. As you guys know, we had some dice on sale at Gen Con of last year, the Dungeon Crawl Classics dice. Those are manufactured overseas. There's a long and not exciting story about the process of trying to manufacture 24-sided objects. Anyway, the good news is they're now in America. The Hue dice were actually shipped out to customers who pre-ordered earlier this week, and the Shanna dice are in America being stuffed into tubes, which is a very fun process. And when that's all done, those will ship out probably in a couple weeks. So that's great news. We're finally past a lot of these hurdles, and hopefully we can do more exciting dice in the future. Now here at the show, we have several new releases. I'm going to show off some cover art and ask some of these guys to talk through them. So, Brendan, I heard you wrote this wonderful module. Maybe you can tell people about it.
I will. So this is my first Dungeon Crawl Classic with the DCC rules that I've published so far.
Tell them, what was the first DCC you did?
The first DCC I did was number 10, and it was the Sunless Garden. And I was, you know, that was with the old, that was 3-5. And I did a few other 3-5 adventures. But this is my first DCC, actual DCC adventure, and I'm really happy with it. I ran it here on Friday, and I was ready to go and not going to miss that adventure.
No.
I did not almost sleep through it. I was practicing faces in the mirror actually at 6 a.m. to really get my monster things on. No, I nearly missed it. But it all comes out of, I ran Sailors on the Starless Sea for some friends of mine, and they were after it, when they all leveled up, they're like, you know, so how do we change our lucky roll? How do we change our birth auger? And I'm like, that's you can't do that. And they were all like, oh, you can't do that. You know, they were all upset that they couldn't eventually change their birth auger into something that would be more useful to their character, and that got me thinking, well, what would adventure be like if if that was the basis of it? So one of the big reward of this, if you survive and actually make it to the hole in the sky, fulfill the achievement and escape with your lives, which, you know, maybe you will. Casualties have run high. But if you do, and you make it back, not only will you have other material rewards, but you'll also have a chance to change the stars that your character was born under. You actually can, if you roll well enough, it's random, you might find yourself able to, you know, like go so far, like not just, you know, change when you were born, who you are, your profession, and absolutely everything about you if you, you know, if you dice well. So that was, it was a lot of fun to work on. It's been my go-to character funnel, like DCC thing. I probably run this 70 times now at conventions, and like now I'm completely off book. Like an hour in, I had to look at a stat block. Yeah, I'm cholesterol. But other than that, you know, it's like, you know, I love doing it, and I'm crazy about writing in the Dungeon Crawl Classics rules. It's so much fun to design in, and the freedom it gives you to really go sort of beyond what you did with the regular style dungeon crawls. And that's I love that. I love that it's kind of like this, and this adventure really let you know I've really kind of like broken every cardinal rule of writing an AD&D adventure, you know, and gleefully broken them all. And I think that's one of the great things about Dungeon Crawl Classics. It allows you that kind of freedom in design, and I hope everyone has the same kind of freedom when they play and feels that same way when they're doing it. So,
awesome. Thanks, Brendan. And if you guys noticed, there's two covers. Somewhere along the way, I noticed that the sketches that Doug would send me for paintings are in many cases as good or better than finished art that I see published in other books. So we've started producing sketch variants of some of Doug's covers. He does really amazing work, and you'll see, if you're here at the show, downstairs we have for sale, among others, the Sailors on the Starless Sea sketch, which is basically finished art as far as I'm concerned. So if you guys want to pick up the sketch cover, we're doing limited runs of these now because they look awesome and Doug does a great job with them. So next one to talk about, Mr. Michael Curtis wrote another module. Mike, you want to tell him about Making of the Ghost Ring?
Okay, so apparently what we do here with Dungeon Crawl Classics is we put a book out that explains the game, and then we write adventures which break all the rules. So this is Making of the Ghost Ring. We've kind of talked about this before in the past, but this is all about the process of creating a magical object in the DCC universe. The characters get involved in the process of enchanting this magical ring, and it takes them on a quest that has them leaping all over the landscape, and it kind of provides the guidelines to set, you know, making a magical item in DCC isn't just a matter of spending gold and time and, you know, in some cases experience points. It's this whole process. It's kind of the version of we did Harley's Adventure where there's no raised dead. Blades Against Death. You know, so it shouldn't just simply be a mechanic. It should always be an adventure to it. So that's the course of this. We've had a lot of fun with this. There are some people who play tested it here in the in the audience, and hopefully they can attest that it was very good. So
I killed Harley. Yeah.
Yes. Yes, that was back during the feuding days. I put Harley in there, so if he's ever done anything bad to you, you can kill him vicariously in there. But I have to say, I only did that because he threatened to make me a gong farmer in Black Mass. But see, he never got around to doing it. So just remember who, you know, who follows up on their vows. So nobody crossed me. That's also downstairs, as you can see, we're also doing the very cover with that. And I'm hoping you dig it. So, yep. That's Harsh Grove. and I believe his dog, the dogs in the photo, in those photos are based on his actual dog's dog. Is that right?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
His dog is called Rusty Jones, and I drew two Rusty Jones in there because two Rusty Jones is better than one of them.
All right.
And then we ran a Kickstarter recently that involved Grimtooth the Troll, and thanks to everybody here for your support. Everybody's played with Grimtooth since the 80s, and putting them all in one book is awesome. And I was going to bring the printer mock-up of that book, but it was too heavy to fit my luggage, because we added on two extra books, as you guys know, and it's now, I think, over 700 pages, if I remember correctly. Yeah, this thing was big enough, but that one's incredible. So as part of that Kickstarter, you guys funded the creation of a Dungeon Crawl Classics module featuring Grimtooth, which is awesome, because Grimtooth has only been in a handful of books ever, and now we have them in the DCC line, and I mean, I was playing with the Grimtooth books when I was a kid, and it's awesome. So Mr. Joe Bittman here wrote that module. There's the cover art. Maybe, Joe, you can tell us about it.
Sure. this module's called Grimtooth's Museum of Death. It is a 27th level adventure for 10 to 12 27th level adventurers. but I've kind of been running it with level zeros mostly. And no one's gotten past the first level yet. So, yeah, so there's, you know, all the traps you like from the Grimtooths books, you know, my favorites at least, I reincorporated them. So it's got like the original art, right, I think? Yeah, the original art, and but DCC-ified traps. There's 99 levels, of which four are detailed. All the maps. All the maps have like little.
Keep selling the joke. Keep selling. Yeah.
Have like question marks for certain things, so you can actually just like pull traps out of Grimtooths and put them in there. So there's places for that. But that being said, the whole thing is complete. It's a complete adventure. You don't need to own any Grimtooths books or have supported the Kickstarter to play this adventure and have fun killing people. So, and yeah. Grimtina and Sludgeworth and some other familiar characters from the Grimtooths books are making appearances. So.
And Jeff did a great job of integrating everything you love about Grimtooth with everything you love about DCC. So you read it, it works really well.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, and the other thing that's cool, there's trap tables, so like floor traps, door traps, that kind of thing. You roll on them and it has like the art and like the DCC explanation, so there's plenty of random traps, so you could like run your characters this multiple times and it'll be totally different the next time they go through.
Hey Doug.
Yes, Joe.
Did you bring that picture we talked about?
Probably not.
The one for Job's other module.
Oh. I did not complete that painting, though I've done a spectacular drawing for it.
You gotta
come and look at it. You can't see it from there.
Alright, let's have.
It's true.
998th Conclave of Wizards.
Good, yeah, right on. Okay, good. We're a well-oiled machine, you guys. So now that we know for sure that we have all the assets necessary for this conversation, maybe, Job, you could talk us through the other adventure you wrote.
Okay, so it got renamed to the 998th Conclave, Wizards Conclave, I think.
Really?
I think so. But, you know, people that are fans of the line know that we like to go back to Appendix N influences. So this one is kind of influenced by Jack Vance's Dying Earth, the Morion stories. I don't know how you say that, but it's Rialto the Marvelous, and there's all these wizards in space. So in the Conclave, involves some space wizard attorneys. It sounds weird, but it's really cool. You guys, you can become one of these wizards if you want to join their secret group. There's advanced spell duel rules. So I don't know if anyone's done spell duels past a certain level, they kind of break down. And so this streamlines, you know, when you have multiple action die for spells and stuff like that, it kind of spells it all out. So now you can do those. Okay. Oh, there's planets you can explore. There's planetary rings, and if we're familiar with the source material, it's you know, their version of Jack Vance's version of space, and you can kind of like breathe in space and other kind of weird things. But it was a lot of fun writing. It's kind of like I would say maybe like a little bit of like mini campaign setting. So for people that like me who like buy modules and just want to use pieces of them, like there's a random wizard layer generators and some other stuff that, you know, if you read the book, you can just like, I want one of those and put it in my game, and you got it.
And it's a great adventure. It is sort of a mini setting, I'd say. But if you guys recall back to the early days of D&D, there's this photo or picture, and I think it's the Red Book edition of D&D by Errol Otis, that has these three wizards squabbling over treasure. You guys know the one that I mean?
Yeah.
Errol Otis is like a huge Jack Vance fan, and that picture is his sort of interpretation of Jack Vance wizards being greedy and fighting over stuff. And for me, it always just captured Jack Vance like in an image. But Job has managed to write an adventure that really just like captures the essence of Jack Vance. So if you're a Jack Vance fan, you read this and it just like, even like word choice, like Jack Vance has crazy words that he throws in there, and Job has crazy words too. And you read this adventure and you really walk away feeling like you're playing in a Jack Vance created setting. So it's a really good job. Yeah. So next up, I hear, Brendan, that you've worked on a DCC RPG version of an X-Crawl book.
I did.
You want to tell everybody about it?
Sure. So that's the cover to Dungeon Battle Brooklyn, which is a first level. Originally, I wrote it with the Pathfinder rules. Who's Pathfinder fans out there? Come on, show of hands. All right, dude, get that guy out of here. You know, I need to have a lot of rule sets to fulfill all of my gaming needs. Pathfinder is one of those, and I you know, really enjoy it. So, but this version is for you guys. So now you can also enjoy X-Crawl with the Dungeon Crawl Classics rules. So I just read over the conversion a few weeks ago, I guess it was, what he sent to me, and it's fantastic. He's done a nice job with it. And, like, he caught, like, there were, you know, he caught things. I was like, oh my gosh, of course he had to change that. Like things I hadn't thought about that had to get changed. It really, you know, the rule set fundamentally changes the kind of stories that you can tell easily with whatever it is system. I mean, easily without having to create a whole bunch of new rules and, you know, call it workarounds, you know? Daniel Bishop did the conversion, and he did a really great job with it. I'm really happy with it. I like the adventure is, this is the thing though, as a first level Pathfinder adventure, it was kind of like kind. Like, you could definitely get through if you just showed some team spirit. Nah, dog, that's those days are gone forever. You really better step quick, you know, or, you know, you will never, you know, see the other side of the Triborough Bridge. You know, like, Brooklyn will be your resting place, and that's where they will find you. But it's, like I said, the conversion is a lot of fun, and if you wanted to try X-Crawl, but you're like, oh, I gotta learn Pathfinder, I don't wanna do it, which, you know, I feel you. This is probably a very good place to start. Which segues into my next project that I'm working on right now. It's called X-Crawl Apocalypse, which is the future of my X-Crawl world, the world that I've been writing in, you know, since 2000 or so, which has now fallen into ruin and is now, you know, ruled by these, you know, sorcerer kings who are trying to bring back the old world by first recreating X-Crawl. So this is going to be the Dungeon Crawl Classics version of X-Crawl. So it's going to be full rules. I gotta say, I actually played it here yesterday for the very first time. Actually, and here's my such. It was just been notes and things in my head and such. And like, I was excited going in, but now it's like it's all I want to work on. Like, going forward, kind of forever, you know, quit my day job kind of thing. Like, I was so excited about it. The play just went really well. I had a great bunch of players, and it was a lot of fun. And you just can't run the traditional X-Crawl world. Just would not work with the DCC rules unless you completely overhaul them and took away all of the awesomeness, like all of the things that would make it, you know, what it is. And the primary reason of the setting is that in the original X-Crawl setting, magic is such a tool of statecraft. It's really how they keep people oppressed. It's why they can have a televised death sport. It's why it all works, you know? And in a world like DCC, using those rules where, you know, sometimes magic works, sometimes magic good, sometimes magic bad, you just couldn't use it to have the kind of control over not just nations, but the world that you have in X-Crawl. So I started trying to just do a standard conversion, and I realized very quickly that the using the DCC rules, in order to do it and to make it still the X-Crawl world, I would have just had to have completely overhauled DCC. And you guys would be like reading the book like, oh man, you know, why would you reinvent Pathfinder? You know, why would you do that? There's absolutely no point to that. So I placed it at a time much further along in the timeline of X-Crawl, where the world has fallen to ruin, magic no longer works the way it used to, like, the balance of magic has been disrupted, so now sometimes you do badly, and there are corruptions and things, which now will take place, you know, in the arena, in front of crowds who maybe will cheer on as your wizard grows tentacles out of his face, or whatever and such. It'll certainly change his picture on the Wheaties box, I think. A lot of that kind of thing goes on. But it's going to keep all of the elements that I think made Pathfinder X-Crawl unique. There's still mojo rules. There are still rules for fame and for a kind of celebrity, the kind of celebrity you can have in a post-apocalyptic world. There are still sponsorships. It's all a little different. It's all tailored to the scenario and tailored to the DCC rules, but I think everyone will have fun with it, and it's going to introduce a few new character classes, including half-orcs, because if you don't have half-orcs, it's not X-Crawl, and then what the hell are you doing, you know? So that's it, and I, like I said, my first game of it yesterday was like, you know, I'm like calling my wife, your game was, she's like, I'm asleep, can you call me? But I was really, really excited with how it all went last night. I had a lot of fun, and sooner rather than later, I'm hoping, so.
It'll be awesome. Yeah, Brendan's been running X-Crawl for about as long as I've known you.
Yeah,
we met. Long time.
X-Crawl was actually my home campaign for a couple of years before I ever thought about, you know, even trying to, you know, write or you know, publish it. So 1999, I guess, is when.
Yeah, that's when I was born. I don't know if you know, I'm quite young. But no, it's great to see this next iteration of X-Crawl. I've seen it go through many different forms, and you're really excited about this one. It's cool. So I'm going to talk a little bit about Free RPG Day, then give Doug the reins to talk through some art he's been working on. So the other thing we're working on, as you guys know, for about a year now, we've been showing off panels of this elusive judges screen, which is slowly evolving. And that guy over there, named Mr. David, got one of them, and we can't get your own. You want to step on stage to
sure.
Be on the camera?
I'm probably going to get rolled in the parking lot. It's going to get stolen.
Yeah, let's do pink hair versus blue hair.
Well, you stole that one anyway. Oh, yeah. So
hey, Dave, how's it going? So, Dave here, in case you don't know, he's also running a DCC tournament, which is awesome. But what we're showing off here is the panel, so what will be the judges screen for DCC RPG, only 3 to 4 years behind schedule. Oh, and see the lady over there pointing to the camera. I think we're supposed to aim at the camera. There we go. There's Jim's camera over there. We got too many cameras. There we go. There we go. You guys look pretty.
Also look like a fan.
So this will come out for free for Free RPG Day at long last. And as I mentioned like a year ago, we will have these three panels and a contest for folks to design an adventure to go with it. So because this is for Free RPG Day, the free one will be on the cheap cardboard. A year or two later, we'll pay more money to put one on the more expensive cardboard, the like thick super stock. And that one will come with, hooray for free. And then that one will come with the adventure that is the winner of the submission contest we're gonna have. So Doug, do you want to walk us through these panels, as well as the cover or the sketch for Job's cover and, you know, Conclave, and anything else you want to walk through?
You don't have to.
Somebody asked me questions, and I'll respond to them. Here. Do you have a question for Doug Kovacs?
No, I'm just marveling at your artwork.
No, I got a question for you.
Oh, this is a question.
Well, I can't. Doug, I hear there might have been some thought given to like with the screen, maybe like where it might appear, where looking at it close up as appeared to looking at it from far away. Is that true?
Doug, I heard that there's a scale issue with these images, and when you step further away from it, like if Rick is now, you can see he's further away, you can see faces in there that you can't see when you're close up because you're distracted by all the marvelous detail. Like you'll never see the big face because you're just looking at all this shit in here. So anyway, yes, that is true. if you look real hard, there's a guy. There's a guy in here. And then there's a guy in here. That might be a lady. So,
I don't see the sailboat.
What sailboat? Shut up. Should I talk about that?
Yes.
All right, so now we got...
Thanks, Dave.
Joe, come over here. Here's your model. It's your thing.
It's okay, this is the artistic process at work.
All right.
So,
it's gonna be like that one, you know, full spread. And there's, he was talking about Jack Vance, and he's got all these weird wizards, and I drew all those weird wizards, and then a whole bunch of other ones. This one's cool. This dude's just a book. And then I put an ape in there with dressed like a wizard, blending in. There's a cat.
How many wizards are there, Doug?
997. No, there's probably like, in this, there's probably like 25. Mm-hmm. But eight of them are descriptions that Joe gave me, and I had to look up what a Pembroke hat is on Google, because I don't know what that is. But it's this. It's that Robin Hood thing that aliens wear. and what's the name of that? Do you know what the name of that is?
I forgot. I had to look it up.
That's not right. No. That's not it. And this guy doesn't look Asian enough for Joe. So he's going to look more Asian. I'll fix that. It'll be a good painting. And one more thing. There's a wizard there, and he's smoking a pipe, and there's a little demon coming out of it. And the demon's smoking a pipe, too.
We'll come back to you in a moment.
Thanks, Doug. So, guys, Doug, as you know, does the cover art for all the DCC books, or like all but like one or two or something like that. So, they look awesome. So, Doug, have you... Yeah, not yet. Hold on. You know what's back there, dude. So next thing to talk about is the other cover art up there, Against the Atomic Overlord. It's by Edgar Johnson. Edgar's not here, so I'm going to talk briefly about it. But there's a term used to describe DCC RPG sometimes, which is gonzo. And the original Appendix N didn't really differentiate between fantasy and science fiction or horror, frankly. It was just sort of all mixed in together. And I like that aspect of the game, and I like that aspect of the origin of D&D. But we decided to take it as far as it would go and then scale back a little bit. So I think Against the Atomic Overlord is probably as far as it'll go. It's a great adventure that includes the characters traveling to another world that has a great threat, the Atomic Overlord, as well as multiple factions you can ally with or fight against. And the ultimate danger in this world is basically an atomic bomb. And the players get to engage with that and either set it off in a good way or a bad way. And thank you, Doug. And among other things, it has an element of ruined technology, including a monorail, like a literal monorail. So if you want to railroad your players, you have a vehicle to do so. And that's actually Edgar's joke. I stole his joke. But it's a great adventure, and it's probably the most gonzo will go, and then we're sort of scaling back from there. But it's a lot of fun because it combines a ton of awesome stuff. You want to comment?
I was going to say, so you say now.
Yes, I am.
My new mission is to out gonzo, out overlord, whatever it takes.
Okay, so there's some things about this painting, okay? See this guy with the mohawk here? Whose character is that? That's Adams.
Yeah.
Okay, see that idiot with the moon hat? Whose character is that? That's Doug's. The lady, that's Gabriel. He couldn't make it. He's in Uruguay right now. And... What's left? Oh, and right there, that hammer, that's, I don't know if I could do it. I'm not going to try.
Do it.
Frost hammer.
Is that right?
Yeah, yeah.
Frost hammer.
So it's a high on fire song.
All right.
Oh, you've met fans.
Yeah. Thanks, guys. All right, Doug, do you mind flipping the next picture? There we go. So this is the cover to Sailors on the Starless Sea, Doug's original sketch. That one's for sale as of yesterday down at the booth, and this is a Gary Con exclusive. So this is, as I mentioned, we're gonna, as we release new modules, do the sketch variants and then sort of slowly go back and reprint some of the originals. But the other fun part about this adventure and Frozen in Time that Mike here wrote and some others is as the first print runs or second print runs start to sell out, you have an opportunity to go back and reprint them. And the way I like to do that is that we go back and we fix all the typos because, you know, we make little mistakes. And
No typos.
Mike's modules never have typos. But we fix all the typos, you know, correct minor things. And then often the writers had ideas they wanted to include, but, you know, due to that word count issue, didn't have room. So go back and give them a chance to throw in whatever it was they really wanted to cover originally. So there might be four extra pages of a little bit of new material. But the other fun part is there's often a lot of additional material to include that there's just not room for. Like, what I like to do is compare the original maps by the authors, and no offense to you guys, to Doug's maps. And it's amazing when you see what Doug does with these sort of, you know, Neolithic pencil sketches that he gets. And then they turn into his amazing maps. And then often there's people who run variants on the module at different cons, and you see how people can transform a basic idea into an entirely different game experience by throwing in, you know, a couple Space Marines or something. So what I'd like to do as we reprint some of these is actually do slim hardcover versions, similar to the Dungeon Alphabet, kind of not a huge volume, but something where we have extra pages in the back to throw in a lot of these add-on materials and variants and what the authors, call it like the director's cut version, what the author wanted to do with the extra material they want to throw in. And there's a version of DC CRPG that was published way back when that was the gold foil cover, part of the original launch. And a lot of people like that design, and of course that one's out of print. But I asked Doug if he could cook up a cool gold foil style demon hole design or demon skull design for some of these modules if we did hardcover versions. Yeah, skull. So let me hand it over to Doug again. I'll get those down for you, and if we can, you can just talk through what you've done with those.
Okay, so I'm talking about these. These are black and white covers done with ink. So Joe had the idea to do like skull versions. You just said it. So of the different modules. So obviously Sailors has got. Is that Molin or Phelan? Does anybody know? It's one of the Chaos Brothers. You know. That's the good looking one. And so anyway, I did that. I think it kind of looks like Rat Fink to me, this one here. And that's what it is. I mean, and then Frozen in Time was slightly more complicated because you gotta figure out how to make a robot have a skull. Apparently that's what it looks like. He's got some crap coming down that look like it's teeth. He's only got one eye. And then he's on top of like a, what kind of man is that on the bottom there, Mike?
Well, this is the first time I've seen this.
Yeah, it's a Cro-Magman.
Yeah.
Okay,
Neanderthal.
It's caveman. It's caveman. It's completely anatomically incorrect because if I just drew a caveman skull, it would just look like a skull. So I made it look like, you know, I tried to make the. I can keep talking about this. I tried to make that brow ridge like more pronounced so it looks like, you know, how cavemen are. Like that.
Do all cavemen look like that?
Yeah. Well, so anyway, that's what I think it turned out. It looks like a Metamorphosis Alpha cover, right?
Yes, absolutely.
It's got feathers and a spear and some technology that doesn't make any sense. Yeah.
So the goal is we're going to print these in gold foil as these.
The goal is we'll print these in gold foil covers on slim hardcover versions of some of these modules. And these are the first two to sell out. as the earlier printings sell out. Yes, they will be hardcover.
I didn't know that.
Yes, that's the idea, yeah. So it's pretty exciting. It'll look really cool. Thanks, Doug.
Yeah, so thank you for buying them all and selling them out so we could do this. And, you know, we could buy them again. And then so I said, so we really appreciate that. At least I do, anyway.
Yeah. And then that leads to another idea. What do you do with all these modules once you have a lot? So this is a printer mock-up, and I've had requests for this like dozens of times. So the basic idea is people ask for something to keep their modules in. Some people ask for boxes, some people ask for, I call these shelf folders, there's different terms. And you know, you can get these at like IKEA and stuff like that, different versions of this. But the idea is that we would produce one that's actually DCC themed, so we'd ask Doug here to do another version of his, quote, spine art. Show him the spine on this. Yeah, of course it'd be... Yeah, I know.
Yeah. What's going on there?
Well, that would be your job, Doug. but the idea is that we could...
Never imagine.
I know, it's crazy. We could even do wraparound art all the way, or just do the spine and some other existing images on the side.
Just reuse the cheap way,
and
just reuse
the area. This is more of that creative process. Yeah. A lot of this goes on behind the scenes. It's cool, don't worry about it.
We just said, this is on tape, right? New art.
Yes, there will be new art. Yes, that's the idea. Anyway, that's, you guys get the basic idea. And if we did this in a certain way where we did a Kickstarter, for example, that sold individual modules, then we could ship you this thing stacked with a module or not, something along those lines. That's the basic idea. I've been asked to produce something like this like basically nonstop for years because people have these collections of modules. So I think it'd be a cool idea.
There's a little front.
That's true. There's a little part on the front.
Mini spine,
yes. So this is in the very early stages. I've asked the printers to go out and sort of tell me how much it would cost to actually make one and things like that. So we're probably, I don't know, 6 to 9 months away, but just wanted to show off the example and let you know that I've heard all the requests and we're working on it. So it should be cool. So now I want to talk about the world tour for a moment. I was wondering if Mr. Jim Wampler could make a cameo appearance. Come on up, Jim. There's a seat right here. You got to sit next to Doug, though.
Thank you.
Running the cameras.
Hey, Doug, do you mind swapping out? Actually, I think it's, sorry. Joe, do you mind swapping out this one? Yeah, there we go. You're good, Doug. So, how's it going, Jim?
It's going great. This is what happens when you survive your character funnel and become a first-level contributor. Good weekend.
So I heard you help produce an awesome tournament for this year's Gary Con. Tell us about it.
Sure. We already ran a session last night. It's called the Hypercube of Might. And it has an actual interesting origin. As you know, Goodman Games has a long history of running tournaments at Gen Con and some of the various conventions back in the 3.5 and 40 days. But there was a problem with doing that for DCC that Joseph discovered, because the system is so swingy. How do you make a tournament fair so you can run it at multiple tables? And how do you score the damn thing? And Harley Stroh is the guy who had the genius idea and cracked the nut and said, we do a tournament character funnel. And the scoring is how many encounters you can get your single level zero PC to survive. You get a stamp. We were stamping the hell out of them last night. So that whole thing was Harley's idea, and it was fantastic at Gen Con. I mean, I sat down, missed an agility roll, boom, I'm dead, I'm out again. I had to get back in line. It was a lot of fun, and there were trophies awarded. And then at my home game store down in Cincinnati, Rick Hall, one of the mutant murder hobos, part of our group, came up with this genius idea. He had so much fun with it at Gen Con, he's like, why aren't we doing this? Let's do an event for Todd's store. So a bunch of us piled in together, did one of these tournament things, ran two tables for 6 solid hours at the store, and it went so well. Joseph heard the reports, and we sort of cooked up this idea between us to create a secret society that is now about to become unsecret. It's the Dungeon Crawl Cabal. It's a secret group of us that have been creating these tournament-level adventures for World Tour 2015. And a few of the members are here today. So the Hypercube of Might is a collaborative effort between myself, Stephen Newton, I'm going to mispronounce somebody's name, so wait for it. Myself, Stephen Newton, Daniel J. Bishop, Dak Altamack, Jeffrey Tadlock, and Adam Iskevich.
Yay!
package.
So there you go.
Great job.
So, and I got to be the editor, so I got to level up as an editor too. And it's running again tonight, 6 to 10. Please come down for it. The basic premise of it is kind of the opposite of Castle White Rock and the opposite of Teagle Manor. We just did away with the entire keep. The keep, all the dungeon levels, they all happened thousands of years ago and vanished and just left the ancient wizard's treasure vault, or maybe tomb, you don't know, sitting out in the middle of a field. And it's like Stonehenge. It's been there so many thousands of years. I like writing things that happen thousands of years later, sometimes with mutants and radiation. But
what are you talking about?
There's none of that in this. And it opens up once a year in the vernal equinox. So the peasants have a festival, and some of them get drunk and decide, hey, let's go into this four-dimensional tesseract and see what's happening. Maybe we'll become gods. That didn't happen last night, but I'm looking forward to it happening tonight.
I heard Mark has the record. Seven encounters?
Six? Yeah, the
we're tied up right now.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Okay. I just got told I have to wrap now, so
it's been great.
Don't forget to tip your DM on the way up.
We gotta do the final encounter.
Okay, all right. We'll make the last bit fast. Thank you, Jim.
I have to say one more thing. Doug was supposed to do the art for this, but he got too busy. So the cover art is J.V. West, who is a really good appendix and theme. And this is his first Gary Con.
Will this eventually be released?
That's a great question, Jim Brinkman. The question was, will this eventually be released? Why, yes. The idea is that this is a finished, usable, ready for presentation PDF format, and if you're going to run an adventure for the world tour this year, you can run this adventure in your home game or at your local store or wherever you might want to run it. So basically within a week or two after this con, we'll have it set up and detailed, so if you're going to run a local game, we'll send you a PDF of that adventure and you can run it at home.
Typo free,
yes. And I'm going to cover a few other world tour things, and we'll cover a few more items. And guys, we may run 5 or 10 minutes late. Sorry, we're wrapping up as fast as we can. So world tour this year, what I'd like to do, something that proved very popular, was in Metamorphosis Alpha, we released this, I don't even know how to say this, cloisonné pen, this fancy little pen.
Cloisonné.
It turned out great, and I love the idea of doing these kinds of pens for the road crew. So as you play games or you're a judge or so on, you get one. So after this seminar, feel free to swing by and grab a whole bunch of stickers. These are stickers for now, but the goal is we'll do a Kickstarter at some point to fund the creation of pens associated with these, because the pens are actually really expensive. And that'll be part of this year's world tour. In addition, Doug has done the art for this year's brass belt buckle. As you guys know, those all originate with Doug's images and then get cast in brass and so on. So this will be available as the belt buckle for those who run a whole lot of games later this year. I think that's it for the world tour stuff. So thank you, Jim. Awesome. Really looking forward to everything you're working on. Because there might be another adventure later on down the road, and maybe even another one later on for other tournaments. We'll see. So a couple last minute things. I guess we have to cut to the chase here. So I told you there'd be a couple of announcements. I'm going to make one, and then I'll be joined by a special guest for a second one. So I'm going to read you guys an excerpt from Appendix N. And when I was working on DCCRPG, this is a piece of paper that I carried in my pocket at all times, which is my copy of Appendix N. I would sort of scratch them off as I found the books and used bookstores and read them. But at the end of Appendix N, this is what Gary Gygax says. The most immediate influences upon AD&D were probably DeCamp and Pratt, Robert E. Howard, Fritz Leiber, Jack Vance, Howard Lovecraft, and Abraham Merritt. And what's interesting about that list is it includes a lot of authors who many of us don't read anymore. Don't give it away. Anyway, Doug's hot to trot here. So
tell me when to do it.
All right, I'll wink twice. 1 week, don't do anything. 2 weeks.
All right.
Okay, so long story short, we have a license from the estate of Fritz Leiber to produce DCCRPG versions of Fritz Leiber's works.
Oh, wow. So,
so this is the cover art for the first installment. And the goal is eventually a large, robust box set with everything you'd ever want to have about the works of Fritz Leiber, Fafhrd, the Grey Mouser, all of it, Linkmar, in one box. We're going to build our way up there and give you guys sort of bits and pieces as we work, because it's a massive project. Mr. Michael Curtis here is the lead on the project. And why don't you tell him about the adventure that will go on sale in about 10 minutes downstairs.
10 minutes.
Some people already left. I think they're sensitive. So obviously, I was extremely. I love getting emails from Joseph because they're always very, very interesting. They like three about a year and a half ago. It was like, you know, have you ever played Metamorphosis Alpha? And do you think you could write from it? And then there was one that was just a picture of a dress from Judges Guild to, you know, Joseph Goodman. The last one was just a picture of a contract and just the state of Fritz Leiber. So I say you have got to be kidding me. So immediately at Gen Con this past year, we had a little meeting. It was Joseph and Brendan and Doug and Harley and myself, and we kind of laid out what we wanted to do. We, you know, we're all fans of Leiber's work. He to me is the biggest influence on how I interpret fantasy. So the opportunity to get to play in this, you know, in this world was just absolutely fantastic. So ever since Gen Con, we have been we've been reviewing the material. I've read the entire series twice now. I have two composition notebooks which are just filled with notes from all the stories of it. And we are trying our damnedest to make, when you're playing DCC Lankmar, which is what we're calling it, it's going to feel like Fritz Leiber's story. We're very, very, we're big fans of Leiber's work. So we want to make sure we get this right. If all works well, and I believe it is considering the crew that we have working on it, the initial box set will work in three ways. It will be for in one sense, even if you have no interest in running a game with a library's material or anything like that, it will still have new spells, we'll still have new monsters, new patrons, new stuff of that, which will be directly incorporated into DCC. The other thing that we'll have, it will allow you to move your character from a DCC campaign into Leiber's world, and it will also present variant rules that if you want to run a game which is very strictly, Leiber-centric, you'll be able to do that as well. So, we're looking forward to it, and that'll be that's the first installment on sale downstairs now.
Thing to talk about, which Jim Morgan is going to join us for a minute.
Yes, but Luke wants us to wrap up really quick, so I'll do it from here.
And we'll show off the art right here.
We're going to do another Kickstarter, Epsilon City. I know. We're going to have cyborgs as player characters, because it's all about the stretch goals. She's going to show right now. Yeah. That's a Jim Holloway piece, pretty amazing. And when are we going to do it? Do you know yet?
It depends on how fast that Jim Ward guy can write.
Oh.
I think we'll probably start in hopefully about 6 weeks or so, once we have everything put together.
So, it's going to be a whole big deal, and it's going to be wonderful for sure. And we're going to have a box set of adventures in Epsilon City. So let's hope you guys will all support that too. Thank you very much.
Thanks, all right, guys. Thank you, everybody.
Live at Gary Con. I'm Joseph Goodman.
I'm James M. Ward.
And this is the James M. Ward who created Metamorphosis Alpha, among many other things. And we're just here to talk a little bit about a project we're going to be working on together.
Yes, another new project. I'm really looking forward to it.
And I hear it's called Epsilon City.
Epsilon City, because there's one big city in the Metamorphosis Alpha Warden Starship, and that's called Epsilon City.
And this is the cover art that artist Jim Holloway did. Tell us about the cover art and how it kind of captures what you wanted it to capture.
Well, you know, I decided that Epsilon City should be filled with Art Deco art, which is geometric shapes. That's basically what Art Deco is. And so you just give Jim Holloway an idea, and he runs with it like crazy. The ruined portion of the city looks just the way I imagined it. And basically what you're dealing with is a city filled with mutant wolfoids, and there's bunches of good technology there. So every creature on the ship wants to go there, but it's super deadly to walk in. And so that image that Jim did just perfectly captures it, because those poor two mutants that are driving a car are about to get attacked by a whole pack of wolfoids.
And now let me flip to the second image that he did. Can you tell me, or tell us?
Oh no, so for my way of thinking, Kickstarters are all about stretch goals. It's all about making interesting stretch goals. And certainly in the Metamorphosis Alpha one of last year, we had terrific stretch goals that are still being talked about today. Well, I figured there's hasn't been a new character class for Metamorphosis Alpha for over 40 years.
40 years.
40 years. So I figured if we make a cyborg, new character class that you can become, it'll be really exciting to people. So one of the booklets in the Kickstarter is going to be, and we'll probably put this high on the Kickstarter stretch goal list, is going to be a cyborg booklet where you can become a cyborg. And Jim Holloway has, again, I said, Jim, give us an attractive girl that's half robot using triangles, continuing the Art Deco look. And that is what we got, and it's just an amazing picture. She is gorgeous, and she's half robot. So I'm really glad he let Jim Holloway do some of this art, because Jim's been doing Metamorphosis Elf art for 40 years, and he perfectly captured the cyborg look in his piece there.
And if this Kickstarter does well, we're going to come out with a second class 40 years from now.
Somebody else will be writing it. We'll be coming out with a new class.
So I heard you had some ideas for add-on stretch goals, including the bracelets and some
Yes, I love doing these stretch goals for MA. And so we came up with the color band idea, and it was kind of interesting to people. And some people have actually tried to collect all the color bands. And so we wanted to foil those people and make them unhappy. So we're going to come up with the ability for people to buy as many of each color as they want. But also, for 40 years, there's never been a new color. And one of the ideas we had for this Epsilon City Kickstarter is to do a brand new band. For 40 years, there hasn't been any new bands for the Warden. And now we're going to do a black military band. There's one half section on the ship that's filled with military equipment, but no mutant has ever been able to get on there because it's so powerfully guarded. So now anybody that has a black band can just walk on and collect brand new power armor, brand new tanks, brand new everything. And then also we're going to have the ability to pick any color or multiple colors you want of armbands for a stretch goal. Because crazy people want to collect all of them for some strange reason. We don't know why.
And they then, must of course, be really crazy.
They must be really crazy. And then we're going to do a black armband. We've never done that before. So it's going to be like an ultimate collectible thing.
That sounds awesome. So I know the maps are really important to you for this project because it's a city and you want to be able to give people the option to actually explore the city.
Yes.
Tell us what you see.
Well, so I've had the map for Epsilon City for 40 years. It's a great big sprawling metropolis. And I've had the different sections that are in the city, but we've never really mapped them out so you can play in the city and walk in the city. In my Epsilon City on the Starship Warden, it's filled with Wolfoids, and Wolfoids in different costumes, because the different apartments had costume themes. We just finished doing a finished pirate Wolfoid apartment theme. So someone goes into the city, they come to this apartment complex, and these great big 9 foot tall Wolfoids in pirate costumes are going arg, because that's what they think pirates should be doing, and they talk to you about becoming a pirate and following the pirate code. And one of the parts of the pirate code is you aren't allowed to ever harm a female. So the poor Wolfoids don't know exactly what to do when females come in the city, because they can't harm them, but the females have no problem harming Wolfoids. So it's kind of a thing they have to work through. So these maps are going to really detail the different chunks of the city, and then you'll be able to walk through the city and play through the dangers of a city owned by Wolfoids.
That sounds awesome. And I know for the format, you're thinking of an awesome box set packed full of all sorts of goodies, but lots of fold-out maps and
yes,
puzzles and things like that.
Exactly. A bunch of different sets, but one of the big deals, of course, is those cyborg characters that we talked about just a little bit. There's never been a cyborg character for the Warden. And now there's a whole booklet on how to become a cyborg and walk the streets half man, half robot.
That sounds cool.
That's the hope.
So this is coming soon to a Kickstarter near you?
You know, I don't know, Joseph. Is it coming soon to a Kickstarter near you?
I bet we use this for the intro, and I bet it'll be coming in like 1 second when people reach this.
Oh, wouldn't that be nice, yes. When do you think the Kickstarter will start?
Very soon, I'm sure.
Very soon. That's the boss being very vague. But yeah, hopefully it'll be done and everybody will be able to play it at like a Gen Con time period. That would be my hope. We'll see what the biggest boss says.
All right.
I'm looking forward to it. This will be really cool.
All right, and once again, I thank you very much for Goodman Games supporting Metamorphosis Alpha. It's really appreciated.
Hey, thanks for a great game. We've loved playing for 40 years.
All right, there we go.
All right, cool. Thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Woo! Easy that is.
Oh, man.
We shouldn't be able to do that. Sorry.